agora você vai passar. And it is also a fact that the devil can affect a person at this time when a person has been defeated in argument. That one who is defeated in argument is vulnerable to the devil affecting him. And as was mentioned, that Muhammad in the debate that occurred between Muhammad ibn al-Hassan and Imam al-Shafi'i, some of the ones who were present at that debate, they said that the one who was defeated in the argument, Muhammad ibn al-Hassan, they said, we saw him at that time, and we saw his face had become red, and we saw that his veins were standing out, and we saw that his buttons were popping off.
ذلك من آفات المناظرات أنها تحمل الإنسان على أن يقول شيئا كان يقول بخلافه، أو أن يقحم نفسه فيما لا يعتقده وما لا يقول به، والحامل له على ذلك المناظرة والمعارضة بين الأقوال. وهذا كما قاله أمير المؤمنين علي بن أبي طالب رضي الله عنه، وهو صاحب أكبر خصومة في تاريخ الأمة الإسلامية. قال رضي الله عنه: إن الخصومات قحمة وإن الشيطان يحضرها. يعني إن الخصومات قحمة، أي أنها تقحم صاحبها في ما لا يعتقده ولا يقوله ولا يريده، لأنه يضطر إلى ذلك حتى لا يخصم، فيقحم نفسه والعياذ بالله في بعض الأقوال والأفعال التي لا يقوم بها.
Point of harm or detriment of arguing is that arguments will lead a person, especially the one who is losing the argument or lost, it will lead him to say things which he hadn't used to believe, or it will lead him into to saying and holding things that he didn't really hold. What will lead him to say that is the fact of saving himself so that he doesn't lose the argument. So if he will say things that he hasn't used to say and hasn't used to believe or doesn't believe. And this is something pointed out by Ali ibn Abi Talib radiallahu anhu, who was the person who took part in the greatest argument in Islamic history, who was the person involved in it. And he said that the basis of debating, they are such that they force the person into that which he doesn't agree or doesn't agree with or doesn't believe. That such that argument, they force him into such cases to say what he doesn't hold or believe.
يقول شيخ الإسلام ابن تيمية رحمه الله تعالى في هذا: وما أكثر ما يحتج به بعض العلماء بحجج ليست من أصول العلم.
شيخ الإسلام ابن تيمية said, and how often it occurs that the people of knowledge use as a proof that which is not from the principles of knowledge.
قد يبدي له ذو العلم مستندا من الأدلة الشرعية.
ذو العلم له مستندا من الأدلة الشرعية.
The light which is produced by knowledge may give him some basis which he uses in arguments.
والله يعلم أن قوله وفعله ليس مستندا إليها.
Maybe the case that Allah knows that his saying and his action does not come from knowledge.
إنما يذكرها دفعا لمن يناظره.
Rather, he only mentions it to repel the one he is arguing with.
وهذا نوع من النفاق في القول والعمل.
It is a type of hypocrisy in speech and in action.
هذا يتعلق في المناظرة. هناك أشخاص أو أنواع من الناس لا يناظرون، أصناف من لا يناظر.
Moving on to another point that needs to be known in the matter of debating, that there are some types of people who are not to be debated with.
الأول المبتدع.
The type is the innovator.
هذا فيه تفصيل.
Needs to be further detailed and further clarified.
مبتدع باعتبار إقامته على البدعة نوعان: مبتدع دخل في البدعة للتو، ومبتدع مقيم على البدعة منذ سنوات طويلة.
There are two kinds here to be borne in mind. First, the person who is upon innovation, he just happened to have fallen in innovation recently, fell into so much of innovation. And secondly, a person who entered into innovation years and years ago and he's been upon it and stayed upon it for a long, long time.
لأن الذي دخل في البدعة لتو ربما يكون عن جهل أو تأويل، فإذا عرف بالحق قبله، بعكس المقيم على البدعة.
Because the one who has just happened to just slip recently, he just fallen into an innovation, just happened to fall into it. Then, by debating with him and giving him proof, and giving him the truth and making it clear to him, he may be pulled out of that innovation. Whereas somebody who has persisted and remained upon it, and remained upon an innovation for a very long time, then he is one who remains upon innovation.
دليل من أقوال السلف على هذا التقسيم مناظرة ابن عباس رضي الله عنهما للخوارج، فإن هؤلاء دخلوا في البدعة لتو، قالوا لا حكم إلا لله، وكفروا علي بن أبي طالب رضي الله عنه، فناظرهم ابن عباس رضي الله عنهما لأنهم دخلوا في البدعة لتو، فرجع منهم ألفان، والبعض يقول رجع منهم النصف، يعني فربما النصف هم الألفان.
The evidence for this fact that there are these two types of innovators in this matter from the sayings of the Salaf is the debate of Ibn Abbas radiallahu anhuma when he debated with the Khawarij. Because the Khawarij at that time, there were people who fell into this innovation due to a false doubt which came up, and it was with regard to the ayah, it was mentioned that with the meaning that indeed judgment is just for Allah, judgment is for Allah alone. So based upon their false understanding of that, They declared Ali radiallahu anhu to be an unbeliever. But Ibn Abbas went, and on that basis he debated with them. So it is said that after his debate, that 2,000 of them, they left, they came back. And some people said that half of them came back. That maybe the 2,000 was a half of them.
أما المقيم على البدعة فهو كما قال الإمام الشافعي رحمه الله تعالى: ما ناظرت رجلا علمت أنه مقيم على بدعة.
As for the one who has persisted upon innovation, and in his regard, from the saying of Imam al-Shafi'i, I have never debated with a man who persists upon innovation.
انظر إلى عبارة الإمام أحمد كما نقلها ابن قدامة في المغني في كتاب الجهاد لما تكلم الإمام أحمد عن حكم قتل الشيخ الكبير. قال الإمام أحمد: الشيخ الكبير لا يكاد يسلم، والشاب يرجى إسلامه، لأن الشيخ الكبير قد شب على الكفر سنوات طويلة، ففي مثل هذا في الغالب أنه لا يسلم أو لا يرجع عن باطله.
Look at the wording of Imam Ahmad as Ibn Qudama reports from him in Al-Mughni in the book of Jihad concerning what happens in the matter of Jihad. When the fighting is occurring in Jihad, what should be done with an old man who is found during the fighting? One finds an old man. Imam Ahmad said about him, an old man, that he will, such a person as that, he will hardly ever accept Islam. With regard to a young man, it is to be hoped that he will become Muslim. So that is to be taken into account. Meaning, an old man, he's lived all his life upon unbelief, and it's not likely that he will accept Islam.
هذا في الغالب وليس على كل حال. فهذا أبو الحسن الأشعري كان مقيما على الاعتزال له 40 سنة وهو في الاعتزال ويناظر على ذلك ويدعو الناس للاعتزال، ثم رجع عن الاعتزال.
What has just been mentioned is something that's generally the case, not always the case, just generally. Because Abu Hassan al-Ash'ari, he was a person who remained upon the belief of the Mu'tazila for 40 years. For 40 years he was upon the belief of the Mu'tazila. And he would debate upon it, and argue with others, defending the position of the Mu'tazila. And then, after all these years, he came back from that, and he abandoned the belief of the Mu'tazila.
المبتدع أيضا لا يناظر لأسباب أخرى أيضا، منها صيانة المناظر والحضور لعقيدتهم من شبه المبتدعة.
The innovators are not debated with for other reasons in addition to this. One of them is to protect the people and prevent them from the false doubts of the innovators, to protect the people from being affected from their doubts that would come forward in a debate or an argument, to stop those doubts affecting the people.
جاء رجل إلى أيوب السختياني، وهذا كثير حتى عن غيره من السلف ومن المبتدع، وراد أن يناظره فقالوا ولا كلمة، يعني ولا كلمة واحدة. قال الذهبي رحمه الله تعالى معلقا على هذا السبب في إعراض السلف عن مناظرة المبتدعة، قال وذلك لأن القلوب ضعيفة والشبه خطافة. يعني هذا المبتدع قد يلقي شبهة واحدة فربما تخطف قلبك وتأثره فترجيك قتيلا لهذه البدعة فلا تخرج منها.
We find Ayyub al-Sakhtiani from the Salaf and many other of the Salaf besides him said similar things. He said when a person came to him, an innovator came to him and wanted to debate with him, so he said not even a single word. So Imam al-Bahabi said, commenting upon this reason, the reason why the Salaf would not debate with the innovators, he said because the hearts are weak. The hearts are weak, and the doubts of the innovators are like thieves. They'll snatch you away. So it may be the case that the doubts of which the innovators have, they seize and catch hold of your heart, and they kill it. So just because you enter into a debate with an innovator, and because of that, one of their doubts seizes hold of you, and you fall into their innovation, and it kills you, and you can't get out of it.
والسبب الثالث في عدم مناظرة المبتدعة حتى لا يشتهروا، فإن أهل السنة إذا ناظروهم ربما كان ذلك سببا في شهرتهم وأيضا طرح شبهاتهم للعامة والخاصة.
Third reason why the innovators are not to be debated with is so that they are not made famous by this. So because if the people of the Sunnah debate with the innovators, then it will make the innovators people, it will make them famous. Make them known amongst the people, and it will allow their doubts to be aired for the people to hear, and it will allow their doubts to be broadcast to the people of knowledge and the general people all alike come to hear their doubts.
أيضا من أصناف من لا يناظر المغالب، يعني الذي يريد الغلبة، فهذا مكابر. لو أتيت بكل حجة ما قبل حجتك، وإنما قصده هو الغلبة، أن يغلبك في المناظرة وأن يخصمك في المجادلة، فمثل هذا لا يناظر.
And the second type of person who is not to be debated with is one who argues for the sake of winning an argument. One who just argues just to win the argument. That's the only reason he argues. Because such a person is a person who is proud, and he is such a person. He won't accept whatever you have to say in a debate with him. He just wants to debate so that he can win and defeat you in arguments. So he's not to be argued with.
قال ابن سيرين رحمه الله تعالى: لا تجادل إلا رجلا إن كلمته رجوت أن يرجع.
Muhammad bin Sirin said, do not debate except with a person. If you debate with him, it is to be hoped that he'll return back from what he's upon.
ذلك من أصناف من لا يناظر الجاهل، لأنه لا علم عنده حتى يناظر، وإنما مقصود المناظرة كشف العلم وكشف الصواب في الأقوال المتعارضة، فأين هذا العلم الذي عند الجاهل حتى يكشف؟
The third type of person who is not to be debated with is the ignorant person, the jahil, because an ignorant person has no knowledge. And the reason for debating is to be done is to clarify the truth and to bring out the truth and make it clear. So the ignorant person, he doesn't have any knowledge. What truth does he have with him? So there's no point in arguing with him and debating with him.
لهذا لما قال أمير المؤمنين الإمام أحمد وقد أحضر ابن أبي دؤاد وهو حامل لواء بدعة خلق القرآن، فقال الإمام أحمد ناظر فأعرض عنه، فقال أمير المؤمنين الإمام أحمد ما لك لا تناظر أبا عبد الله، يعني ابن أبي دؤاد، فقال الإمام أحمد لا أعرفه بعلم حتى أناظره.
The Khalifa in the time of Imam Ahmad during the trial of the creation of the Quran, when Ibn Abi Du'ad, who was the forebearer, the flag bearer of the saying that the Quran is created, and Imam Ahmad was brought forward, and the Khalifa said to him, debate with him. So Imam Ahmad didn't say anything. So the Khalifa said, why won't you debate with Abu Abdullah, meaning Ibn Abi Du'ad? He asked Imam Ahmad, why don't you debate with him? So Imam Ahmad replied, I don't know him to have any knowledge such that I should debate with him.
لذلك العلماء يفقهون هذا، فلا يجيبون كل من يسأل مناظرتهم إلى المناظرة، وبعض من لا علم ولا فقه عنده يظن أن ذلك ضعفا وعجزا وأنه خوفا من الهزيمة.
This is a point that the scholars are well aware of. They're well aware of this fact. So they do not respond. The scholars do not respond to everybody who comes to them and wants to debate and wants to argue and wants to argue with them. Sometimes they don't respond to that, and they will not debate. So some people who do not have knowledge, they falsely think this is because the scholars they cannot win that debate, or that the scholars are afraid that they will lose the argument, whereas this is not the case. In such cases the scholars won't debate with them because these are ignorant fools who don't have any knowledge, so they're not to be debated with.
من أجل هذا قال الإمام الشافعي رحمه الله تعالى من إذلال العلم أن تناظر كل من ناظرك وأن تقاول كل من قاولك.
Why Imam al-Shafi'i said part of the debasement of knowledge is that you debate with everybody who wants to debate with you, and you speak against everyone who wants to speak against you.
المناظرة المنتدعة فيه تنبيه مهم، وهو أنه لا يناظرهم إلا العلماء، لأنه إذا هزم صاحب السنة فهذه هزيمة للسنة، فالجهل والعوام الناس يقولون لو كان هو صاحب الحق لما هزم، فبهذا يتغير مذهب الناس من الحق إلى الباطل، ويعني الباطل على الحق بسبب تصدر الجاهل لمناظرات المبتدعة.
With regard to the fact, with regard to debating with the people of innovation, the ones of them who are to be debated with, nobody is to debate with the people of innovation except the person of knowledge, except the scholar. Because if a person of the Sunnah, he just happens to be a person of the Sunnah, but he hasn't got sufficient knowledge, he's not a scholar, and he debates with the people of innovation, if he loses the argument, then the common people who witness the debate, they'll see a person of Sunnah being defeated by a person of innovation, and the common people, they will therefore see the Sunnah being defeated by this innovation, they will think that they don't know, they will think that that innovation is more right, because it's one of the arguments. So therefore they will follow that innovation and fall into that innovation because of this argument, because the person with someone who didn't have knowledge lost the argument.
وهذا ما حصل للمتكلمة علماء الكلام، هؤلاء أرادوا نصرة الإسلام فطلبوا الدين من علم الكلام والجدل ليردوا على الفلاسفة، لكن كما قال شيخ الإسلام هؤلاء لا للإسلام نصروا ولا للفلاسفة كسروا، ما استطاعوا يهزموا الفلاسفة ولا استطاعوا نصرة الإسلام، بل بعضهم دخل في الحيرة والشك وبعضهم ارتد عن الإسلام. يعني
Imam and this is precisely what happened to some of the people of the theological rhetoric al-kalam, the people of theological rhetoric, the ones who thought, and that what they did, they thought to try and aid the Sunnah. Initially they thought to try and aid the Sunnah by arguing against the philosophers. The way which the people of theological rhetoric, they thought to defend the Sunnah with their own way of theological rhetoric. So they entered into arguments based upon that with the people of philosophy, and they were defeated by the people of philosophy in argument. which is why Shaykh al-Islam Ibn Taymiyyah said about them that they didn't aid Islam, they didn't aid or bring victory to Islam, and they didn't defeat the philosophers either. And as a result of this, many of these people's kalam, many of them that were there for, because they lost the argument, many of them were thrown into doubt and confusion, and others besides them became apostates.
هذا يجرنا إلى قاعدة وحقيقة في هذا الباب، وهو أن النظر أوسع من المناظرة. يعني معنى هذا الكلام، ليس كل من عرف الحق أمكنه أن يؤديه إلى غيره. فهناك فرق بين معرفة الحق وبين تأديته وتبليغه إلى الغير والمحاجة فيه والمجادلة عنه. فليس كل من عرف الحق أمكنه أن يؤديه للنفس، فقد يعجز عن تأديته للنفس، كما هو معلوم في قول الشاعر: وفي زخرف القول تزيين لباطله، والحق قد يعتريه سوء تعبيره. يعني القول الباطل يزخرف بالكلام، فهذا عنده قدرة على تبليغ قوله وإقناع الناس في قوله فيقبل الناس قوله، وهذا صاحب الحق، هو صاحب الحق، لكن ما عنده قدرة على تبليغ الناس فيه. وفي زخرف القول تزيين لباطله، والحق قد يعتريه سوء تعبيره.
Leads us to a further principle and a further reality. Which is that understanding is a matter which is broader than debating. Meaning that a person may understand the truth, may have comprehended and understood the truth, but will not necessarily be able to put that to somebody else and be able to debate it and clarify it to somebody else. Not everybody who knows the truth can debate upon the truth and can convey that truth to somebody else. And that is why the poet said, a line of poetry was quoted, two lines, that the saying that it may occur that a false saying may be falsely adorned. A false saying may be made to look attractive. By a person who is arguing, and he's very good at arguing, he makes a false saying sound to be sound that it's true. Whereas the truth may suffer from inability to express. So there may be a true saying, a person may be upon the truth, but he can't argue, he can't debate, and he can't express it. So therefore it seems that it's not the truth.
بعض الناس دائما يتحدى الناس في المناظرة، أتحداك ناظرني. يقول ابن القيم: الذي يتحدى في المناظرة لا يخلو من حالين، إما أن يكون أجهل الناس، وإما أن يكون أعلم الناس. فأنت فتش في كل من يدعو إلى ويتحدى الناس في المناظرة، يقول: أتحداك، تعال ناظرني. ويتكرر من هذا كثيرا، فهذا إما أن يكون أعلم الناس، وإما أن يكون أجهل الناس.
Then there is a further point. There are some people who are very frequently challenged. They're challengers, and they will very frequently challenge others to debate. And say, I'll challenge you to debate. I'll challenge you, and they keep challenging. They'll keep challenging to debate. Right? Ibn al-Qayyim said that there are two types of people who do this. There are two types of people who challenge to argument. Firstly, the most foolish of the people. Secondly, the most knowledgeable of the people. Either of these two types will challenge people to debate.
من أعلم الناس ممن كان يناظر ويتحدث المناظرة شيخ حسام التيمي رحمه الله تعالى، لأنه كما ذكر في مجموع الفتاوى المجلد الثاني والثالث أظن، قال: وأنا أتحدى كل وتحدى لمدة ثلاث سنوات، أمهل خصمي لمدة ثلاث سنوات أن يأتي بقول خالف في الكتاب والسنة أو السلف الصالح.
The people who are most knowledgeable of the people who challenge people to debate with him, or to come and debate, was Shaykh al-Islam Ibn Taymiyyah. The Shaykh mentioned it was either in volume 2 or 3 of Majmu' al-Fatawa. He laid down a challenge. It's recorded that he laid down a challenge, and he said, I challenge any of these opponents, those who oppose me, I challenge them. But within a period of 3 years, I challenge any of them to come forward and show where in a single occasion I have gone against the book أو بالسنة أو بالدين أو بالسلف.
هناك صنف من الناس يخاصم ويجادل في كل صغيرة وكبيرة، ويتتبع المناظرات والمجادلات ويبحث عنها ويحمل الناس عليها بسبب أو بغير سبب. فهذا النوع من الناس كان السلف يتهمه في نيته.
And there is another type of person who will seek out a debate in any matter. They'll seek to debate in any matter whatsoever, whether it's something small or something great, or whatever the case. They will seek it out and strive to debate wherever they can. And this type of people, the Salaf, used to question their intention. Used to question their intention because of this.
قال أبو عثمان الجوعي رحمه الله تعالى: إذا رأيت الرجل يخاصم فاعلم أنه يحب الرئاسة، يعني يخاصم يعني كثير الخصام والجدال، فاعلم أنه يحب الرئاسة.
أبو عثمان الجوعي said, if you see a person who loves to debate, then know that he loves leadership. If you see somebody who loves to debate, know he is a person who loves to attain leadership.
وأكمل أنواع المناظرة أن تكون على سبيل المشاورة، تعرض الأقوال على سبيل المشاورة، ويكون فيها أخذ ورد وعرض للأقوال والأدلة حتى يظهر الحق على سبيل المشاورة، حتى يقطع الطريق على الشيطان، بحيث أنه ما يدخل من باب المخاصمة والغلبة. وهذا أكمل أنواع المناظرة، وهذه كانت تحصل للصحابة رضي الله عنهم.
From the most perfect and complete type of debating is that which is done with mutual understanding, and it's done, as the chef said, with consulting. It's debating done in a manner of consulting. In such a way that proofs are put forward and the truth is taken, and what is not correct is left. And between the people like that, and in order to get what is correct, and in such a manner that the way is cut off for the shaitan, so he is not able to enter. This manner of debating, that is the way in which it was done between the companions.
الحديث أيضا فيه مباحث كثيرة، ربما في درس آخر نكمل جزء آخر من الموضوع، والله أعلم.
This topic, of course, has further branches that need to be clarified. The chef mentioned that maybe, inshallah, that this will be done in a further or future lecture. We'll pray this to Allah and may seek and blessings here from the Muslim. Any questions?
ولكن الحق له سعيد من الله تبارك وتعالى، ولا بد أن يظهره الله تبارك وتعالى. فأنا أنصح بنصيحة الإمام مالك رحمه الله تعالى، يقول: لا تجادل بالسنة، اعرضها فإن قبل منك وإلا فلا. يعني لا تجادل بالسنة، طبعا تعرض الحق اللي معك من خلال طباعة الكتب، توزيع الشفاء، تبين الحق، لا تدخل في مناقشات على طول مع هؤلاء، ولأنه ما تنفع في الغالب، أنه يعني من الأسباب التي ما ذكرناها في مناظرة البدع، لأنه ما تنفع لهم المناظرة. يقول أبو الفضل الأصبهاني في كتابه الحجة في بيان المحجة، يقول: ما رأينا من زمن السلف إلى زماننا هذا رجع أحد عن مذهبه إلى الحق. طبعا هذا في الغالب كما ذكرنا عن أبي الحسن الأشعري أنه رجع إلى الحق، لكن في الغالب أنهم لا يرجعون، فيكون مناظرتهم عبث وتضيع الوقت بما لا فائدة. أعرض السنة وأعرض الحق، اكتب في هذا، وزع أشرطة، بين الحق، وخلاص لا تجادل. يترجم أولا
In this country, he advises, in light of the fact that the Sunnah in this country is in a state of weakness and innovation, there are many innovators, and innovation is stronger here, and the innovators have much wealth in this country, the innovators have many centers in this country, and the innovators have publications and newspapers. And the Sheikh mentions that in this situation like this, then what we should do, we should put forward the truth, and Allah will indeed aid the truth, and will cause the truth to be clarified and manifested. And he says that he gives us the advice of Imam Malik, who said, put forward the truth, but don't debate with it. You produce books. You produce books and produce tapes so that you put the truth forward. But mostly debating with these people of innovation won't produce any benefits, because they're firm upon their innovation, and it will not, and debating with them, they won't want to listen, and it will not produce any benefit by arguing with them. Which is why we find the saying of Abu Fadl al-Asfahani, who's in his book Al-Hujjah min
al-Hujjah
min al-Sunayh fi Bayan al-Muhajjah, that he said, not from the time of the Salaf right until our time now have we ever seen anybody who left that which was false and futile and came due to debating, he left what was false and futile and came to the truth. The Sheikh mentioned that was general. This is some people now and again, it happened now and again, but generally it didn't happen. It wasn't true.
بالنسبة للسؤال الأخ، نحن نتكلم عن الحكم الفقهي بالنسبة للقراءة خلف الإمام بغض النظر عن نوع المسجد الذي يصلى فيه، هل هو مسجد قصد على التقوى ولا لا. الصلاة تختلف هل هي سرية أو جهرية. أما الصلاة السرية فيجب على الإمام والمأموم أن يقرأوا بفاتحة الكتاب، وأي صلاة ما يقرأ في فاتحة القراءة الفاتحة في الصلاة السرية ركن للإمام والمأموم، لا تصح الصلاة بدونها لقول النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم لا صلاة إلا بأم القرآن، متفق عليه. أما الصلاة الجهرية فهذه التي اختلف فيها العلماء وهي ليست محل إجماع، اختلفوا بالنسبة للمأموم، أما بالنسبة للإمام فيجب عليه أن يقرأ فاتحة الكتاب. لكن المأموم هل يجب عليه أن يقرأ الفاتحة بعد الإمام أو ينصت لقراءة الإمام في ما يقرأ بعد الفاتحة؟ أبو حنيفة رحمه الله تعالى ذهب إلى أنه لا يجب على المأموم أن يقرأ، وأنه يكفيه التأمين، يعني أنه إذا قال آمين فكأنما قرأ الفاتحة، واستدل بذلك بقول النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم من كان له إمام فقراءة الإمام له قراءة. واضح؟ وهذا القول أيضا مال له شيخ الإسلام ابن تيمية رحمه الله تعالى كما في مجموع الفتاوى. طبعا هذا الحديث الذي استدل به أبو حنيفة رحمه الله تعالى حديث ضعيف، يقول البخاري في كتابه جزء القراءة خلف الإمام، له كتاب اسمه القراءة خلف الإمام، يقول وهذا الحديث اتفق العلماء من أهل الحجاز وأهل العراق على تضعيفه. فالسلام استدل بالقرآن على هذا القول، على أن التأمين يكون بمنزلة القراءة، يعني يكون الذي أما كأنما قرأ. قال لأن الله تبارك وتعالى قال عن موسى، موسى دعا ربه عليه، دعا ربه موسى، دعا موسى عليه السلام ربه، قال ربنا، قال موسى ربنا إنك آتيت فرعون وملأه زينة وأموالا في الحياة الدنيا، ربنا اطمس على أموالهم واشدد على قلوبهم فلا يؤمنوا حتى يروا العذاب الأليم. قال الله تبارك وتعالى قال قد أجيبت دعوتكما، الاثنين مع أن الداعي موسى، لكن أمن هارون فقال الله تبارك وتعالى قد أجيبت دعوتكما، فكأنما المؤمن قرأ أو دعا لما قرأ به الداعي أو قرأ به القارئ. هذا رأي شيخ سامي تيمية، وهذا الاستدلال حقيقة لا يصح، لأنه دلالته دلالة مفهوم فحوى، لأنه معارض بدلالة منطوق حديث عبادة بن الصامت الذي رواه الترمذي في مسنده وصحه ابن حجر والنووي وجماعة من أهل العلم ومذهب الشافعي وهو الصحيح، أن النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم صلى الفجر فثقلت عليه القراءة، فلما انفتل من صلاته أقبل على الصحابة بوجهه فقال لعلكم تقرؤون وراء إمامكم، فقالوا نعم يا رسول الله، فقال لا تفعلوا إلا بأم القرآن. فهذا يدل على أنه يجب عليهم أن يقرأوا أم القرآن، وأنه لا يجوز لأحد أن يقرأ زيادة على ذلك في الصلاة الجهرية، وهذا مخصص لقوله تعالى فإذا قرأ القرآن فاستمعوا له وانصتوا، يعني لو استرسل إمام بعد ذلك قرأ بعد هذا لم يترك فرصة للقراءة الفاتحة، فإنك تقرأ الفاتحة أو تقرأها في سكتات الإمام، قال الحمد لله رب العالمين تقول الحمد لله رب العالمين، قال الرحمن الرحيم قال الرحمن الرحيم، لابد. لكن من اعتقد مذهب أبي حنيفة أو شيخ الإسلام ابن تيمية وصلى وأمن وهو يعتقد ذلك فهذا صلاته صحيحة، لأنه هذا مذهب لبعض أهل العلم وهو يرى أنه صلاته صحيحة، فإن شاء الله أمره إلى الله عز وجل أنه صلاته صحيحة، لكن يبين له ويوضح له يعني بالمشاورة، ها ما هو بالمناظرة أيضا، يوضح له وينصح ويبين له، فلا بد أن يقرأ فاتحة الكتاب، والله أعلم. هذا السؤال اللي فيه كتب.
The question was, abridging the question and the answer, the question was with regard to a certain mosque, the people pray there and they don't recite Surah Al-Fatiha. So is this correct that what they do, they don't recite Surah Al-Fatiha, and they say that we're followers of Abu Hanifa and he didn't approve of reciting that Surah Al-Fatiha needs to be recited in the prayer. So is this correct, basically? So the Sheikh mentioned in answer to this, that the answer is based upon just a fifth ruling with regard to reciting Surah Fatiha, not with regard to any mosque, this mosque or that mosque, or whether a mosque is founded upon piety is correct or not. Just the answer with regard to a fifth question about necessity or otherwise of reciting Surah Fatiha. So he says the prayers are of two types, as we know. The prayer which is recited quietly, like the Zuhr and Asr prayer, says in those prayers, the Imam and the one praying behind the Imam, they must recite Surah Fatiha, and it's a pillar of the prayer for both of them. For the Imam and for the followers, that they recite Surah Al-Fatiha, it's a pillar of the prayer for both of them in the quiet prayer. And as shown by the hadith, the authentic hadith, that there is no prayer except with the foundation of the book, meaning Surah Al-Fatiha. Then the Shaykh mentioned with regard to the prayers where the Imam recites loudly. He said that with regard to that prayer, there is no ijma, there's not an agreement with regard to that. The scholars differ. But in such a prayer, the imam must recite Surah Al-Fatiha. As regards the follower in such a prayer, then Abu Hanifa is of the view that a follower, when the imam recites loudly, as long as the follower just says Ameen, then that will be sufficient for him, and it will count for him. And he uses a narration that is, whoever has an imam, whoever is following an imam, then the recitation of the imam is sufficient for him. And this argument, the same argument, was used by Shaykh al-Islam Ibn Taymiyyah in Majmu' al-Fatawa. But of course this hadith is a weak hadith. Al-Bukhari said in his book, Al-Bukhari got a whole little small book on this matter, called a little a treatise about reciting behind the Imam, and he said, the scholars of the Hijaz, the Mecca and Medina area, and of Iraq, they're agreed that this hadith is a weak hadith. And then, the proof that Shaykh al-Islam Ibn Taymiyyah brings forward to show that it's not essential in a loud prayer to recite behind the Surah Al-Fatiha behind the Imam is that if a person recites, if the Imam recites Surah Al-Fatiha, you keep quiet, and when he's finished and says Ameen, you say Ameen, and that will be sufficient for you. How, once he's been as proof of this, he says the story of Musa and Harun, when Musa alayhi salam made supplication against Fir'aun, the ayah was mentioned in the Quran,
ربنا انك اتيت فرعون وملأه زينه وامر
بالحكمه. Well, Musa alayhi salam said, oh Lord, that you have granted Fir'aun much wealth and adornment, and so on. It continues,
ربنا اطمس على اموالهم,
oh Lord, destroy their wealth. And the supplication was made to destroy their wealth, and at the end of the supplication, our Lord said that he was I have responded to the supplication of the two of you. Whereas what happened, Musa alayhi salam, he was the one making dua. And all that Harun did, he said Ameen. So our Lord, Musa alayhi salam was making supplication, and Harun said Ameen to it. So our Lord said that he had responded to the supplication of the two of you. So even though Harun just said Ameen, our Lord mentioned the supplication being the supplication of both of them. So one of them, even though he just said Ameen, he counted as having made the supplication. The Shaykh al-Islam Ibn Taymiyyah uses it as a proof that one who says Ameen, when he remembers that sort of psyche, he said Ameen, it's the same as if he recited it. So he doesn't need to recite it. So the Shaykh mentioned this view of Shaykh al-Islam Ibn Taymiyyah, this argument is not supported by this book, because this is an understanding from a text. It's something that is, you know, can be understood from that text, but where we have a clear text which says something different and shows the opposite to this. The hadith reported by Tirmidhi and declared authentic by Ibn Hajar and Nawawi, and it's the position of Imam al-Shafi'i as well, that one must recite Surah Fatiha based on the hadith, that one day the Prophet ﷺ led the people in the Fajr prayer and said, after the prayer, he said to the people, perhaps you recite behind your Imam. So after, they said that they did. So afterwards he said, then do not do so. And do not do so except with Fatihah al-Kitab. Do not recite except with Fatihah al-Kitab. Don't recite except with Fatihah al-Kitab. So he told them not to recite, but made an exception for the Surah Al-Fatiha. And so this hadith, it particularizes the ayah from the Surah of A'raf, which mentioned about when the Quran is recited, that remain silent. He said this hadith is particular to that. Particularizes that. So that is Surah Al-Fatiha, an exception, you must recite it. If you are able, if the Imam leaves a gap, after reciting, leaves a gap in the space, then recite it then. Upon whatever the case, you must recite. And with regard to these, the people who are upon a different view to this, then you should speak with them in a good manner and get them to understand this point. And don't debate about it, you'll get them to understand in a good manner. And the Sheikh mentioned this is a matter which whole books have been written about. The question is, it the blameworthy debating that Imam Ahmad said in Usul al-Sunnah we should abandon?
الإمام أحمد في أصول السنة نهى عن المناظرة في شيء معين في المجادلة في القرآن أو في رؤية الله تبارك وتعالى، لأنه قد يحصل جدال ورد الأقوال في هذا، وهذا يكون كفر، لأن مراءة في القرآن كفر واضح يا أخوان. من أجل هذا نهى الإمام أحمد عن هذا النوع من المناظرة، ولا الإمام أحمد له مناظرات أيضا.
Mentioned the Imam Ahmad in Usul al-Sunnah his forbiddance of debating was a particular kind of debating. And it was debating with regard to the matter of the Qur'an. The Qur'an, arguing about it being the truth, that is not created. He forbade arguing about this point. And forbade arguing about the theme of Allah. And arguing about these matters. Because having a debate about these matters, anybody who opposes these matters in the debate, they're upon kufr, they're upon unbelief. And that is not to be allowed. And argumentation about the Qur'an is to unbelief.
Well, I think I took out eight actually.
This is the eighth one.
Seven. Okay, it matters about aqidah. It is required to adhere to the wording employed by the Sharia and avoid all innovative wording. Okay, so in matters of aqidah, right? We've now said that we've shown that the aqidah is in the Quran and Sunnah.
Allahu sallam wa barak ala nabiyyina Muhammadin wa ala alihi wa sahbihi ajma'in. Tabarak wa ta'ala. Man jama'ana fi baytin min buyutillahi tabarak wa ta'ala. لنتذاكر ونتدارس في أمر ديننا ونرى في هذه الأزمنة ما هو مكتوب ومسموع من أمور المناظرات، وهذا الفن قد يظن البعض أنه مقتبس ومأخوذ عن اليونان من علم المنطق، وهذا ليس بصحيح، بل في الكتاب والسنة من التنبيه إليه والإشارة إليه، وعند المسلمين من العلم به ما هو أعلم مما عند أهل المنطق. وسنذكر أدلة هذا وما يتعلق بهذا الموضوع من فقه وآداب وأحكام في هذا الدرس.
Abu Anas, hafizullah, began the praise of Allah and by sending salat and salam upon the messenger. All praises for Allah who has gathered us in one of the houses from the place of worship, as a reminder to sit and listen to a reminder for us, and that we may study the affairs of our religion, and that from the affairs that are known these days and are seen and that are written about is the matters containing matters about debating and the manners of debating. So the Sheikh said that with regard to debating, that some people may be under the false impression that anything to do with debating, the principles for this are taken only from Greek philosophy, and that this is actually something false, because the book and the Sunnah are sufficient for us and have sufficient text, so we have no need of any philosophy from Greece or anywhere to teach us the manners in which debate should be carried out. Rather, there are the texts of the book and the Sunnah that are sufficient for us in that regard, which the Shaykh will mention to us in this lesson. And he will also mention, inshaAllah, something of the fiqh of debating and the manners of debating and the rulings connected to it.
أولا نتحدث عن الأدلة من الكتاب والسنة والإجماع وفعل الصحابة وفعل الأنبياء عليهم السلام على مشروعية المناظرة.
Initially, the Shaykh will mention the proofs for the correctness of debating from the book and the Sunnah and the Ijma, the consensus, and from the companions and from the prophets.
أدلة من القرآن قوله تبارك وتعالى ولا تجادلوا أهل الكتاب إلا بالتي هي أحسن.
From the proofs of the book is the ayah with the rough meaning that, and do not debate with the people of the book except in the way that is best.
الله تبارك وتعالى ادعو إلى سبيل ربك بالحكمة والموعظة الحسنة وجادلهم بالتي هي أحسن.
And the saying of Allah the Exalted and Most High, call to the way of your Lord with wisdom and wise preaching, and debate with them in a way that is best.
أيضا نجد أن الله تبارك وتعالى أثنى في القرآن على علم الحجج، بل ونسب علم الحجج والرفعة فيه إلى أنبياء الله تبارك وتعالى. فبعد أن ذكر الله تبارك وتعالى مناظرة إبراهيم عليه السلام لعباد النجوم الصابعة بعد أن خصمهم إبراهيم عليه السلام، قال الله تبارك وتعالى وتلك حجتنا آتيناها إبراهيم على قومه. فهنا سمى الله تبارك وتعالى هذا العلم بعلم الحجج وأضافه إلى نفسه. ذلك أيضا من هذا الباب من علم الحجج أيضا ما سماه الله تبارك وتعالى بالسلطان، عندكم من سلطان بهذا، وهذا السلطان يقول شيخ الإسلام ابن تيمية رحمه الله تعالى السلطان في القرآن نوعان، سلطان القدرة وسلطان العلم. وقال ابن عباس رضي الله عنهما كل سلطان في القرآن فهو الحجة والبيان.
Mentioned that in the book Allah has indeed praised the knowledge of giving proof and debating with proof, and he has attributed this as being the way of the prophets. So our Lord, when he mentioned about the debate which Ibrahim alayhi salam had with the unbelievers from the Sabi'ah and how he defeated them in arguments, and then our Lord described this as being that this was our proof. So our Lord attributed the proof to himself as being our proof. So the science of proof in argument, our Lord has attributed it to himself. And also from this is the word as-sultan, which is also a description, sultan being authority in argument or physical authority. And as was said, do you have any sultan? Means do you have any proof or authority for what is being said? And Shaykh al-Islam ibn Taymiyyah, he said, when the word sultan is mentioned in the Quran, it carries one of two meanings. Either the sultan, the proof of knowledge, or the sultan of authority and power. And Ibn Abbas radiallahu anhuma said that sultan in the Quran, it means proof and clarity of proof.
ذلك نجد أن في القرآن ذكر الحجة الصحيحة والتنبيه والإشارة إليها وإبطال الشبهة الفاسدة والرد عليها، كما قال الله تبارك وتعالى: لو كان فيهما آلهة إلا الله لفسدتا.
Indeed, we find in the Quran, in different places, a mention of correct proofs in arguments, and a praise of correct proofs in arguments, and a demolition of false doubt. And as was said, the ayah that was quoted with the meaning that indeed, if in the heavens and the earth there were others who deserved to be worshipped, then it would result in total corruption.
ذلك أيضا قوله تبارك وتعالى: ولا يأتونك بمثل إلا جئناك بالحق وأحسن تفسيرا. هذه الآية استدل بها جماعة من أهل العلم على مشروعية المناظرة، منهم شيخ الإسلام ابن تيمية رحمه الله تعالى في نقد المنطق، وكذلك العلامة محمد أمين الشنقيطي رحمه الله تعالى في كتابه آداب البحث والمناظرة.
With the meaning that they do not bring you any example in argument, except that we bring you the truth and that which is better in explanation. So the scholars have understood from this ayah that it is indeed a proof for the correctness of debating. Most of these scholars were Shaykh al-Islam Ibn Taymiyyah in his Naqd al-Mantiq. Likewise, Muhammad al-Amin al-Shanqiti in his book, The Manners of Researching and Debating.
وجه الدلالة من هذه الآية هو أنه إذا كان المشركون يجادلون ويحاجون في باطلهم، فالله تبارك وتعالى يعطي نبيه من الأمثلة والحجج ما هو أحق وأصح
مما عند أهل الباطل، مما عند أهل الباطل.
And this ayah is a proof in the sense that since our Lord that indeed the mushrik should be debated despite the fact that they are upon what they are upon is false and futile, yet they are to be debated with in that. And our Lord, he gave the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam the best and most excellent proofs for that argument.
والأدلة من السنة كثيرة في حصول المناظرة والمجادلة بين النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم وأصحابه، أو بين النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم والمشركين أيضا، كما ناظر النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم المشركين في تحريم التائبة والوصيلة والحام. كذلك ما حصل من مناظرة بين النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم وعمر بن الخطاب رضي الله عنه في شأن أسارى بدر، وما حصل من مناظرة من النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم لأصحابه في صلح الحديبية، فهذا كثير جدا وفيه من الدليل على مشروعية المناظرة والمعارضة بين الأقوال وإظهار الصواب في هذه الأقوال.
The proofs from the Sunnah of the correctness of debating are many. From them are those that show that debating between the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم and his companions, and between him and the mushriks, and amongst what occurred with the mushrik is the argument that the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam debated with the mushriks concerning these various animals which are they used to sacrifice in a false way and do their false practices with them. So the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam debated with them about that. And also the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam debated with Umar with regard to what should be done with the captives from the Battle of Badr. And also he debated with his companions concerning the sulh, the peace treaty of Hudaybiyah. And
أما الإجماع فهو منعقد على مشروعية المناظرة وجوازها، كما حتى ذلك الخطيب البغدادي رحمه الله تعالى في كتابه الفقيه والمتفقه.
With regard to the إجماع, the consensus, then there is indeed consensus upon the fact that debating is permissible. This is mentioned by Al-Khatib Al-Baghdadi in his book Al-Faqih wa Al-Mutafaqih.
أما فعل الأنبياء عليهم السلام فهذا أيضا معلوم مشهور عنهم، كما أخبر الله تبارك وتعالى في سورة هود: قال الملأ من قوم نوح عليه السلام لنوح قالوا يا نوح قد جادلتنا فأكثرت جدالنا.
From the example of the prophets, proving that they debated with the people, and this is something well known and something famous from them. For indeed, as is mentioned in Surah Hud, the people of Nuh said to him, that, O Nuh, and I was mentioned with the meaning that indeed Nuh, the people of Nuh, alayhi salam, said to him, O Nuh, you have debated with us, and you have debated a very great deal with us.
ما قص الله علينا من خبر المناظرة بين إبراهيم عليه السلام والنمرود، فالنمرود ادعى الربوبية فناظره إبراهيم عليه السلام كما في سورة البقرة، قال الله تبارك وتعالى: ألم تر إلى الذي حاج إبراهيم في ربه إذ آتاه الله الملك إذ قال إبراهيم ربي الذي يحيي ويميت قال أنا أحيي وأميت، قال إبراهيم: فإن الله يأتي بالشمس من المشرق فأتي بها من المغرب فبهت الذي كفر، أي خصم وانقطع عن المناظرة والمحاجة.
In the story of Ibrahim عليه السلام and the Nimrud, the one who claimed lordship for himself. For as is mentioned in Surah Al-Baqarah, Ibrahim عليه السلام argued with him, debated with him. And our Lord mentioned about this, and the ayah was mentioned from Surah Al-Baqarah with the meaning that do you not consider the one who debated with Lord, with Ibrahim concerning his Lord, when he said, when Namrud said that I am your Lord, he said I give life and I give death. So Ibrahim alayhi salam, when he mentioned that Allah gives life and gives death, Namrud, he claims that I give life and I give death. So Ibrahim alayhi salam said to him, then Allah brings the sun from the east, he brings the sun in the morning, if it's up in the east, then you, if you are correct, you bring it up from the west. So the unbeliever was refuted in argument, meaning his argument was refuted and stopped, put an end to.
أيضا فعل الصحابة فإنهم كانوا يتناظرون في المسائل وهذا كثير عنهم جدا، وأشهر المناظرات في ذلك ما حصل في سقيفة بني ساعدة لما توفي النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم وطلب الأنصار أن يجعل منهم أمير ومن المهاجرين أمير، فناظرهم أبو بكر وعمر رضي الله عنهما في أن الأئمة من قريش، فحصلت المناظرة المشهورة في سقيفة بني ساعدة. كذلك ما حصل من مناظرة بين أبي سعيد الخدري رضي الله عنهما وابن عباس، بين أبي سعيد الخدري وابن عباس رضي الله عنهما في ربا الفضل، فإن ابن عباس قال إنما الربا في النسيئة، يعني ما في ربا في الفضل، فناظره أبو سعيد الخدري في هذا، إلى غير ذلك من المناظرات الكثيرة التي جرت بين الصحابة، مما تدل على أن الأمر شائع مستفيض منتشر مشتهر بينهم.
The examples where the companions debated amongst themselves are very many and well known. Amongst them is what happened in the enclosure of Banu Sa'ida after the death of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, when they debated about who should be the Amir, the chief afterwards. So the Ansar, they said that the Muhajirs can have a leader, and we, the Ansar, will have a leader as well. So Abu Bakr and Umar went and they debated with them about this matter, and they overcame them in arguments and with the facts, with the hadith, that indeed the rulers are to be from Quraysh. And there occurred the debate between Abu Sa'id al-Khudri and Ibn Abbas with regard to usury, with a certain branch of usury.
ربا الفضل الزيادة الزيادة المفاضلة
with regard to usury, different forms or classes of usury, usury of excess, an amount in excess, and
الفضل
and ربا المسيئة, two types that they were debating about. Ibn Abbas رضي الله عنهما said that the first, the excess figure when a deal is gone through, there's an excess figure involved. Ibn Abbas said this particular matter is not from usury, whereas Abu Sayyid al-Khudri declared that this was usury, and he debated with him in this regard, and there are many other examples besides.
هذه مجموعة من الأدلة في مشروعية المناظرة. أيضا طبيعة الإنسان أنه مجادل، الإنسان ذو جدل كما قال الله تبارك وتعالى: وكان الإنسان أكثر شيء جدلا. قال ابن عطية رحمه الله تعالى الأندلسي في كتابه المحرر الوجيز، قال: الإنسان أكثر جدلا من كل من يجادل من الأصناف والأجناس الأخرى كالملائكة وغيره. فالإنسان أكثر الأجناس مجادلة.
What is preceded is a number of proofs showing the prescription, and that it is debating is something correct and prescribed. And on top of these is the fact that it is within man's nature that he debates. Allah said about mankind that indeed mankind is one who debates greatly. And commenting on the ayah that was mentioned, Abu Hayyan from Andalus, he mentioned in his book Al-Muharrir wal-Wajiz, Ibn Atiyah from Andalus, he mentioned that in the book Al-Muharrir wal-Wajiz, that this ayah means that man, the type of man, mankind, his type is that he debates more greatly than any other type who debates, whether it is the angels or anybody else from any other species who debates. Mankind is the one who debates the most.
وهذه الآية لها سبب نزول أيضا، فإن النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم طرق فاطمة وعلي بن أبي طالب رضي الله عنهما ليلا فقال: ألا تصليان؟ فقال علي بن أبي طالب رضي الله عنه: إنما أرواحنا بيد الله، فإذا شاء بعثها. فانصرف النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم وهو يضرب فخذيه ويقول: وكان الإنسان أكثر شيء جدلا.
It was just mentioned. Indeed, mankind is the one who greatly, very greatly debates or argues. Then the Sheikh mentioned that there was a reason why this ayah was sent down, and it was that the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam he visited Ali radiallahu anhu and his wife Fatima radiallahu anha one night, and he left them. When he had said to Ali radiallahu anhu, "Why do you not pray during the night? Why do the two of you not pray during the night, in the night prayer?" So Ali radiallahu anhu, he said that, "Well, Allah takes our souls, meaning in sleep, Allah takes our souls in sleep. And if He wishes, He'll send them back. And then we can pray. If Allah gives the souls back, then we'll pray." So the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam left, and he was striking his thighs, and he quoted this ayah. Indeed, mankind is with the meaning that indeed mankind is the one who greatly debates or argues.
خبرنا أن جنس الإنسان أكثر جدل من جميع الأجناس الأخرى، وجنس الإنسان الرجل فيه أجدل من المرأة.
What is stated has shown that mankind as a type debates more than any other type of being, any other angels or whatever. And within the type of mankind, the man is more argumentative or more debate than the woman.
الدليل قوله تعالى ويا الله قوله تعالى عن المرأة: أو من ينشأ في الحلية وهو في الخصام غير مبين. يعني معنى هذه الآية عن المرأة أنها ناقصة، وأنه يثمرها الحلي تتزين به، وأنها في المجادلة وفي المحاجة ليست قوية. لكن هذا العموم يا أخوة باعتبار الجنس، يعني جنس النساء أضعف في الحجة والبيان من الرجل، لكن قد يوجد في أحد النساء من هي أجدل من بعض الرجال كما نشاهد.
Mention the ayah concerning the women. Indeed, they're ones who live and are adorned with adornments. They're completed and adorned with adornments. But in argument, they are weak. The women are weak, and so one of the things that improves them is adornments. But in argument, they are just weak. So the Sheikh mentioned that this is with regard to the women in general. Women in general are weaker than men in argument. They're weak in argument. But it does not stop the fact that individually, there may be individual women who are stronger in argument than some of the men.
قال قتادة رحمه الله تعالى في هذه الآية: أو من ينشأ في الحلية وهو في الخصام غير مبين. قال: ما احتجت امرأة بحجة قط إلا عادت عليها.
Qatada from the Tabi'een said with regard to this ayah that has preceded that no woman has ever argued with an argument except that it turned back upon her. Except the argument turned back upon her.
No, I'm listening to you laugh. Thank you. ايضا لابد ان نعرف في المجادله المناظره انها نوعان، جزء موهبه من الله عز وجل وجزء مكتسب يكتسب الانسان بالمعرفه.
Mentioned that with regard to debating, then debating is a two thoughts. One is a natural ability which Allah has placed in the person, and it's just naturally granted by Allah to give him an ability to debate. Second part of the ability to debate is something which a person learns or earns.
موهبة هذه لا شك أن بعض الناس أقوى بحجته من بعض، والأدلة على هذا كثيرة، كما جاء في حديث أم سلمة في الصحيحين قال النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم أنكم تختصمون إلي ولعل بعضكم أن يكون ألحن بحجته من بعض فأقضي له بنحو ما أسلم، فمن قضيت له من حق أخيه شيئا فإنما هي قطعة من النار استطاعها. فالشاهد قوله صلى الله عليه وسلم ولعل بعضكم أن يكون ألحن بحجته من بعض، فبعض الناس أقوى الحجة من بعض، هذا موهبة من الله عز وجل.
In regards to the first part of the ability to argue or debate, that which is granted naturally by Allah to people, then some people are granted a greater share of it than others. Some people are stronger in arguing than others are in arguing and putting forward the argument. As occurred in the hadith of Salama reported in the Sunan Sahih, that the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said that you people dispute or come to me and dispute in front of me. Some of you may be better able to state his argument than others, so that I should hear the argument of one and judge in his favour. So whomever I judge in his favour with the right of his brother, then it is a piece of the fire for him, and if he takes it up, then he will take it up, a piece of the fire. So the proof from that is the part where it's mentioned that some of you are better able to state his argument than others, are better able to argue his case than others.
كذلك ما قصر الله علينا من خبر الخصمين الذين احتكما إلى داود عليه السلام في سورة الصاد، فقال أحدهما شاكيا إلى داود عليه السلام إن هذا أخي له 99 نعجة ولي نعجة واحدة، فقال أكفلنيها وعزني في الخطاب، أي غلبني في المخاصمة وفي المجادلة.
And on this is what our Lord mentioned in Surah Saad with regard to Dawood alayhi salam and the man who came to him with regard to the sheep and said that this is my brother. My brother, he has 99 sheep, and I've only got a single sheep. And he's trying to get back, and he has beaten me. He's got the better of me in arguments.
أيضا ما قاله كعب بن مالك رضي الله عنه عن نفسه كما جاء في صحيح البخاري ومسلم، فإنه تخلف عن غزوة تبوك، ولما رجع النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم من غزوة تبوك جاء المنافقون والأعراب يعتذرون، كل واحد يقدم عذرة في تخلفه. فجاء كعب بن مالك رضي الله عنه وما قال إلا الصدق، يعني قال ليس لي عذر في التخلف، لكن ماذا قال قبل ذلك؟ قال ولقد أعطيت جدلا. يقول النووي معنى كلامه أي براعة وقوة في الكلام وبلاغة، بحيث أخرج من عهدة ما ينسب إليه، يعني هو يعلم من حاله أنه مجادل ولم يستطيع أن يجادل النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم، فيعذره النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم في تخلفه، لكن خشي من الله وصدق مع النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم. لكن شاهد قوله ولقد أعطيت جدلا، فبعض الناس عنده موهبة في المحاجة والمجادلة.
Advises from this is what Ka'ab ibn Malik رضي الله عنه said about himself as is reported in the Sahih of al-Bukhari and of Muslim concerning those who didn't go to the battle of Tabuk, those who stayed behind from the battle of Tabuk. And so then when the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam came back with his companions from the battle, and the hypocrites came forward and presented their excuses, and the desert Arabs, they came forward and presented their excuses why they weren't present. And then Anas ibn Malik, Ka'ab ibn Malik's turn came, and he said about himself, and I came forward, and he said, and I was given strength in arguments. I'm a person who's got strength in ability to argue and debate. But he didn't do so, rather he remained silent. He didn't argue with the Prophet ﷺ and give his arguments and argue his case. He remained silent out of fear of Allah. But the point is that he said that I stayed silent, but I was, even though I was given strength in debate, in arguments, in arguing, which again shows that some people are given different strength in the ability to argue and debate.
هذا أيضا ما قاله الشافعي رحمه الله تعالى في المزني، فإنه رآه صاحب حجة وجدل وبيان، قال هذا لو ناظر الشيطان لخصمه.
Likewise, Imam al-Shafi'i said with regard to al-Muzani, he said about him, when he saw that he was a person who was very strong in being able to argue, he said, al-Muzani is such a person that if he argued with the devil, he would defeat him.
ذلك أيضا ما هو معلوم من سيرة الشافعي في المناظرة والمجادلة، فإنه كان رحمه الله تعالى يناظر محمد بن الحسن صاحب أبي حنيفة في مذهبه فيخصمه الإمام الشافعي، ثم يقول الشافعي لمحمد بن الحسن تقلد مذهبي وأنا أتقلد مذهبك، فيتقلد مذهبه الذي خصمه فيه فيناظره فيه فيخصمه أيضا في نفس هذه الكرة في نفس المسألة، حتى قال بعض من حضر المناظرة رأيت محمد بن الحسن بين يدي الشافعي كالكرة يقلبها كيف كان.
Likewise, we see from the life example of Imam al-Shafi'i himself, because he indeed is extremely strong in argument and debating, and he debated with Muhammad ibn al-Hasan al-Shaybani, the student of Abu Hanifa. He debated with al-Shafi'i, debated with him, and defeated him with regard to his position. So he debated with him and he defeated him in arguments. And then Imam al-Shafi'i said to him, then you take on my position for arguments, you take up my position and I will take up your position, which he's already just defeated. And then Imam al-Shafi'i argued it again from his standpoint, and Imam al-Shafi'i defeated him again. He kept defeating him. So one of the people present in the audience, they said that Muhammad ibn al-Hasan al-Shaybani, he said he was just like a ball in the hand of al-Shafi'i for him to play with every life.
ذلك المناظرة الفقه العلم المناظرة أيضا يكتسب، يعني يتعلم الإنسان بعض مسائل العلم والمناظرات والمناقضات والقطع لذلك قيل الإمام الشافعي رحمه الله تعالى من أقدر الفقهاء على المناظرة؟ قال من عود لسانه الركض في ميدان الألفاظ.
And with regard to the second part of the ability to debate, that which a person gains through experience and learns, learning how to debate and how to defeat in debate and arguing. Then concerning this, Imam al-Shafi'i said, somebody asked him how this is earned, how a person gains this, and he said something like,
من عود لسانه الركض في ميدان الألفاظ.
That he plays something like he puts his tongue in the field of playing around with words or arguing with words.
هذا يجرنا إلى حقيقة، وهو أنه ليس المنتصر في كل حال هو صاحب الحق، كما في حديث سلمة أنكم تختصمون إلي ولعل بعضكم أن يكون الحل بحجتي من بعض. فإذا ليس المنتصر في المناظرة على كل حال هو صاحب الحق.
What has just proceeded, it then leads us to a further reality, and that reality is that the person who wins an argument is not always the person who is correct, not always the one who is correct in that matter, as was shown by the fact that the hadith of Salama, when the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said that you come before me and you dispute, so some of you may be better able to argue in case than others. So if I give anyone the right of his brother, then the rest of the hadith, it shows that the one who wins the argument is not necessarily the one who is correct.
ويتفرع على هذه الحقيقة حقيقة أخرى، وهو أنه لا تترك الحقائق لتعمية المناظر. كما قال الإمام مالك رحمه الله تعالى قال: أكلما جاءنا رجل أجدل من رجل تركنا ما نزل به جبريل على نبينا محمد صلى الله عليه وسلم.
This reality leads us on to another reality. That is the fact that we do not abandon the truth just because somebody is able to defeat in arguments or in debating. Somebody can win an argument does not mean that therefore we will abandon the truth. As Imam Malik said, is it to be the case that whenever a man comes to us who is better able to debate than another man, that we will therefore abandon that which Jibreel descended with upon Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam.
هذا يجرنا إلى تقسيم مجادلة إلى قسمين: مجادلة محمودة ومجادلة مذمومة. المجادلة المحمودة هي المجادلة بالأدب لإظهار الحق.
This fact leads us on to the point. So debating or debating is therefore falls into two categories: that which is praiseworthy and that which is blameworthy, that which is good and that which is not good. So that which is good and praiseworthy is debating that is done with the correct manners in order to manifest the truth.
المجادلة المذمومة ثلاثة أنواع: المجادلة بغير علم كما قال الله تبارك وتعالى: ومن الناس من يجادل في الله بغير علم ولا هدى ولا سلطان مبين. وقال الله تبارك وتعالى معيبا على اليهود والنصارى: المجادلة بغير علم، ها أنتم هؤلاء حاجزتم فيما لكم به علم فلما تحاجون فيما ليس لكم به علم، والله يعلم وأنتم لا تعلمون. هذا القسم الأول من المجادلة المذمومة، وهي المجادلة بغير علم.
Category of debating is the blameworthy and bad kind of debating, and that itself, the blameworthy debating, is of three kinds. First, debating without knowledge. The ayah was mentioned amongst the people. There are some who argue, who debate without knowledge and without guidance and without clear evidence. And concerning the Jews and the Christians, our Lord mentioned about them, and the ayah was mentioned that indeed part of it was the Jews debate about that which you have no knowledge of. The end of it was that indeed Allah knows and you do not know.
النوع الثاني من المجادلة المذمومة: المجادلة بالباطل لقصد غلبة الحق ودحضه، كما قال الله تبارك وتعالى: وجادلوا بالباطل ليدحضوا به الحق فأخذتهم فكيف كان عقاب.
Kind of blameworthy debating is debating with falsehood in order to try and defeat the truth. And the ayah was mentioned with the meaning that those people they debated with falsehood in order to defeat the truth. The Lord mentions that he took hold and punished them. He punished them, and how severe was his punishment?
أرك هناك النوع الثالث من المجادلة المذمومة: المجادلة بعد ظهور الحق، وهذا مذموم لأن الحق قد ظهر وأبان، فالمجادلة بعد ذلك عبث لا فائدة فيها، وهي إيش؟ تدل على كبر وإعراض عن الحق بعد وضوحه. يقول الله تبارك وتعالى في سورة الأنفال: يجادلونك في الحق بعدما تبين لهم.
A kind of blameworthy debating is debating after the truth has become manifest. After the truth has become clear and manifest, still after that arguing. So arguing after the truth has become clear is just futility, and it contains no benefit. All it does, it shows that the person is a person who is proud and a person who wants to turn away from the truth. It was mentioned with the meaning that they argue with you about the truth after it has become clear to them.
كذلك أيضا لابد أن نعرف أنه في حال المناظرة تحصل حيل بين المتناظرين. طبعا الحيل في الشريعة ممنوعة، لكن بعض الفقهاء وبعض العلماء عندهم حيل يتحايلون فيها في المناظرة، فينتبه الإنسان إذا حصلت له مناظرة حتى لا يفتال عليه. قال أبو حنيفة رحمه الله تعالى لأصحابه وتلاميذه: إذا ناظرتم فأظهروا الضحك يقضي لكم الجمهور بالغلبة. طبعا هذا ما ينبغي، لكن هذا يعني فيه إشارة إلى أنه أحيانا يتحايل البعض فيضحك حتى يظن الجمهور أن الحق معه.
Sheikh mentioned that the fact that we must know is that when the argument, there is argument, debating or argumentation, that one thing that is used is using tricks, or using basically using tricks to win the argument, or using means very ploys to use to win the argument. So the Sheikh mentioned, of course, this is something using ploys and tricks. It's not something correct and not something that should be done. But we need to be aware that people do this to win an argument. So we should be aware of that fact that this occurs. And then the Sheikh mentioned that one of the things that Abu Hanifa said to his students, he said that when you debate with anybody, that after the debate, that show to the people that you're smiling or laughing, because the majority of people will therefore think you've won the argument because you're happy and you're smiling. But Sheikh mentioned it's not something correct that it should be the case, but it was mentioned as being a way of winning an argument and making people think that the argument had been won when maybe it hadn't.
حصلت حيلة في مناظرة بين فقيهين عالمين كبيرين، فلما دخل الإمام مالك رحمه الله تعالى على هارون الرشيد، وكان هارون يوقر الإمام مالك رحمه الله تعالى، وكان الإمام مالك رحمه الله تعالى مهيبا، فأجلسه هارون الرشيد بجواره، وكان في المجلس أبو يوسف، فكأنه حسده لذلك، فقال أبو يوسف للإمام مالك في حضرة السلطان: ما تقول في رجل أسقط ثنايا ضبي وهو محرم؟ فقال الإمام مالك: فيه الفدية. فقال أبو يوسف: وهل للضبي ثنايا؟ فغضب الإمام مالك رحمه الله تعالى، فقال لأمير المؤمنين: هذا رجل ما وقر مجلس أمير المؤمنين.
There's a trick used in one debate that occurred between two very great and famous scholars. So one time Imam Malik entered upon Harun al-Rashid, the Khalifa. And Imam Malik was greatly respected by Harun al-Rashid. Harun al-Rashid had very great respect and greatly honored Imam Malik. So one time Imam Malik entered upon him. And in the gathering, Abu Yusuf was sat there. So in the presence of the Khalifa, Abu Yusuf tried to debate with Imam Malik, and he asked him a question in front of the Khalifa and said, what do you say about the person who is in a state of ihram, going for Hajj, person in the state of ihram, and he breaks the teeth of something like a deer, a wild deer or antelope or something. What do you say about a person who breaks his teeth? It's a molar teeth. So Imam Malik said that he should pay expiation. He should do expiation for having done that. He should expiate for what he has done. So Abu Yusuf said, and does the antelope have molar teeth? One is the logic. Antelope, has it got any molar teeth? It doesn't have them. So Imam Malik said that this is a man who doesn't respect the gathering of the Khalifa. He doesn't show respect for that.
من فوائد المناظرات إظهار الحرج وكشفه، وهذا يكون مع الإنصاف.
From the benefits of debating is clarification and manifestation of the truth and making the truth clear, and this will occur if debating is done with justice.
كذلك من فوائد المناظرات زيادة في نماء الذهن وتنقيحه، ولأن ملاحات الرجال تنقيح للأفهام كما قال المزني رحمه الله أو عمر بن عبد العزيز رحمه الله تعالى.
Likewise, from the benefits of debating is increase in one's mind, in one's mental faculties, so they increase and improve by debating, as Umar ibn Abdul Aziz mentioned in this regard.
لكن أيضا المناظرات لها آفات وأضرار، لأن الشيطان يحضر المناظرات، لأن الإنسان دائما ما يحب أن يفوق أحد من جنسه وأن يعزمه ويخصمه، لا سيما في حضرة الناس. فهنا يجد الشيطان هذا المكان وهذا الوقت، يجده مرتعا خصبا لبث تلبيسه وشروره بين المتناظرين.
There are indeed benefits for debating, so there are also indeed harms that it causes. And there are detrimental effects of debating. And from the harms of debating, is the devil, Shaitan, he becomes present at the places, whether it's argumentation, whether it's arguing or debating. Shaitan will attend that place. Because of the fact that a man doesn't like to lose an argument. By nature, a man doesn't like to use an argument, doesn't like to lose an argument, especially for the people who are present. He didn't like to be defeated in arguments. Therefore, knowing this, the shaitan is present there so that he can use this opportunity to put his bits of poison and put his falsehood into that argument, so the man will take it up and try and win the argument using whatever he is inspired from the devil with.
من أجل هذا قال مسلم بن يسار رحمه الله تعالى: إياكم والمراء، فإنها ساعة جهل العالم وعندها يبتغي الشيطان زلته. رواه الدارمي.
The fact that the devil uses such times to introduce his poison into a place is why Muslim Ibn Yathar said, beware of the places of debating, because that is a time when the scholar slips. At the time of debating, at the time when the scholar makes slips. And that was what he tried to do.